different ways. You can tie two pieces end to end, or I just start in the middle like this and leave one end short because I'm going to be splicing in here as I go along to make the cordage. And again, it's better on a bare thigh, much easier. But we're not going
to. How do you make the bear sit still?
Yeah.
That man a rib shot.
I've got an even more terrible joke, but I don't say it. Mixed company. But anyway, so what you do, hold it with your thumb like this. Somebody, I won't say who, just showed the making cordage on TV, and I was rather embarrassed because they had two pieces that weren't even connected at the top. You got to have it connected up here for it to stay together. So this is connected because it's the same piece, but you see where my thumb is? And sometimes they would do that much. I like to keep it finer and tighter. And about that far apart, I'm going to take my hand and I'm going to roll both pieces up this way, like this. Just going to roll right up. Roll both. See what's happening? Mm-hmm. See that? Mm-hmm. And then kind of hit a point where it's together. Let go. And just naturally, the torque brings it back. And then come back down. I'm gonna repeat it just so you can see it. And you can, depending on what you're making the cordage for, like if I was making a bowstring, I'd just be super careful, super slow, super tight, everything right, of course. If you're making a carrying net, it doesn't matter. There's so many doublings up on it. But there, I'm gonna get it a lot tighter this time. I still got it too close together too soon, but you see what's all the tension there. Let go, cordage. Come back down, tighten it, and now we'll work our way down, and then we'll splice a piece, and then you'll virtually know everything.
Well, now we know everything.
Just like magic.
I'm gonna make some sandals next.
I'm gonna make.
Do you ever meet a pair that fit your feet?
Oh, those are mine.
Those are our new feet.
Oh yeah.
Rest the car.
How long will they last?
Well, I'll tell you about that in a minute. See how tight this is?
Is that what it is?
Yeah.
So it doesn't unravel.
So you have to do that.
No, it's all that torque in it. See, that's why I'm rolling it, to put all that torque in it.
What is the back roll?
You're twisting both together.
It just tightens up what it does on its own naturally. Yeah.
So you're just pulling it back, give it a little more tight.
Yeah, I'll do it slower this time when I come back.
I thought you're trying to pull it.
Yeah. Well, it's kind of hard to
pull. Paul is kind of an old Indian lady, so.
No, I come up like this, try to get them as close to possible. Let go. See what happened there? Now when I come back, I'm just giving it the same kind of roll, backwards.
But you're still, now you're holding the end. Again.
Yeah, but yeah. You move your fingers, your other end.
I let go when
it, initially.
And then grab it again.
Then
otherwise it won't do anything, it just goes down like that. Yeah. So this is extremely sturdy. We'll go down a few more and we'll get to here. It won't take too long.
So would that be like a double cordage? Or a double?
Well, this is called two-ply cordage. Now, this stuff is not great fiber. With that Mojave yucca, the Indian lady down there, she would make it this thin, single ply. In other words, she's just feeding in fibers. And they're only that long, agave fibers, for that long. And she's just feeding them in, single ply, and it still makes a tough bow cordage. Unbelievable.
Bow cordage?
Bow!
Oh my God.
Yeah. I didn't believe it. I thought she was fooling me. And so I had one of her bows with that cordage, and I had to take it home and take it all apart to convince myself. You know?
This is a lot of pressure.
Thank you. Yeah. Of course, it's not a heavyweight bow. It's probably a 35-pound full bow.
Still a lot of pressure.
Yeah.
All
right, three
flies. Yeah, I'd say everybody has their own technique. She would be doing it like this. Yeah. Wow. Yeah. But I have to work within my limitations. And sometimes too, when it doesn't taper down nice here, you can take a flake and just take a little bit off, or whatever it takes.
How would you make it longer?
Well, yeah, there's no way to make it longer. This is it. No, that's what we're going to do right now. That's what we'll do right now.
I'm just wrapping up a piece here.
Yeah.
You got to find a very big yucca plant.
Well, I remember once I went down there and she made me a clay canteen, or a ceramic canteen the old-fashioned way. But I have the two little holes for cordage. I said, well, where's the cordage? Where's the thing to hang it from? Oh, I didn't have any cordage. Oh, Jesus. I said, God, I wanted some cordage on that thing. Oh, she sat down in her little hut, and there's like little strand pieces like that I'm looking at right here. Like one piece here and one piece here. She just started to put those on her knee and started to do this, grab another piece. And pretty soon she had a big long piece of cord.
Wow.
That was out of out of Santa Catarina. You have to remember now, when I'm dampening it like this, it affects the cordage, and how it affects it is that when it dries, it contracts a little bit, so it won't be as tight. So there's a little trade-off there. You have to remember that, especially when you're doing a dog bane, because it's possible to do it with dog bane without.
When it contracts, it should get tighter.
Well, I mean this thickness will contract. It swells up a little bit. So the less you can get away with, the better. Let me do this a little slower so you can see. Here's the second piece. Here's the first piece. Here's my thumb. This is coming over this way and down. See this piece right here, the short piece I'm going to splice? It doesn't matter if you have a lot of things sticking out. When you get through with your cordage, you just run it through a fire real quick and it'll burn all the loose ends off and make it look perfect. She did it so it was perfect the first time, but sometimes they don't. Well, oftentimes they didn't, you know, the Indians. But anyway, here's what you do. Just lie it on there. See what I'm doing?
Uh-huh.
And then grab it with your thumb right here, like that. I should charge you for this because it took me hours to figure it out. You know, she was trying to hide it from me. I just did it so fast. So you see what I'm doing? Just laying this on here like this, grabbing that little intersection with my thumb. And now, as long as I can keep these together like that, we're all set to go.
She wasn't really trying to hide it. She was just doing it so fast.
No, she enjoyed it. She enjoyed fooling me.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I mean, we were good friends, but you know what I'm saying.
Yeah.
She was having a little fun with me. Now, I'm a little bit careful about the splice. So I come back and pull. That's the splice right there.
Wow. Can't even see it.
And now we'll do another one more, and then. Pretty tight.
Actually, the more tension you put on it, the tighter the splice gets.
Is that right, huh?
Yeah.
That's
the way splices work.
Interesting. It seems logical when I think about it. Can I have is there a little flake around here somewhere? I don't something that's a little sharp there. I'm thinking just to make it for aesthetic reasons. It doesn't matter, but you know, just to make it look a little better. Well, then I need another piece there too. Wait a second. Yeah, just grab me another piece there.
Yeah. How did I not know this? Why was I not born with this?
That's a little thick too. I'm just going to rip off a piece of that.
You showed them the books that you make after. You showed them the final product and how you're putting all the knowledge in these books.
Oh, yeah.
Is that really impressive?
It does. Yeah, the ones who really know are very cooperative and very thrilled that I would do something like
right.
this. People that don't know shit want to pretend like, oh, you're stealing from us or something like that.
Oh, yeah. You're just letting it be passed on forever.
Absolutely.
Well, otherwise, it's going to be lost.
I don't make anything out of it. We're doing the same thing right here, by the way. I'm just being a little bit careful, so I make sure I get that splice in there. Any questions?
Yeah, how do you do that?
I should get everybody's name so that, you know, during the week people will come over and say, well, you know, I missed your class. Mm-hmm. No.
When you say four ply, is it just four little tiny strands?
Well, let me just show you in a second here.
Oh, okay.
I'll give you an idea what I'm talking about. I haven't done it for a long time, but I'm sure I can figure it out.
The pigment colors. Which one was the biggest surprise of how they created the color?
Blue.
Blue?
Yeah. It's a really a perceptual blue. It's not a true blue at all. They make it out of white and gray.
Really?
Gypsum and charcoal.
Wow.
Yeah. That's a long story.
A long afternoon.
I had to buck the people at Getty Conservation Museum on that one. They thought they had it all figured out.
Well, they were wrong?
Yeah, I think they were wrong. Totally wrong. I said, well, then duplicate it for me.
Right.
Well, that's been done. Well, who did it? They couldn't come up with the answer. So they had a real strange explanation for it.
And the ghost came in and did it in the middle of the night.
Yeah. But I was able to reproduce it.
Wow.
And find literally scores of examples for it.
Right.
I can reproduce it right here if you want.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, come on over sometime. I've got pigments with me, and I've got the materials to do it. It doesn't take but a minute.
Oh, really? 1 minute you can make it?
Yeah, it's perceptual. It's not a... Now, I'll just leave it like that so you can see what it's like. Now, you say four-ply. Well, this is two-ply, see?
Mm-hmm.
So four-ply is just the opposite. You would just take this and put it like this. Mm-hmm. And instead of doing this, because that will just unravel everything, you do this. See? Well, I'm trying to remember how to do it. I've made bowstrings. They just spin so long, though. There, like that.
Oh.
See?
Yeah.
That's four-ply.
Wow.
Yeah. Well, in the Northwest Coast, they would use iris fiber. And they would start out so thin and beautiful. They go 4-ply, 8-ply, 16-ply. I mean,
wow.
Oh, and it's perfect. Just insanely gorgeous.
How many
stuff.
Plies would it take to hold the weight of the average man?
I don't know. I do know I've talked to Havasupai guys. I went to Havasupai study, trying to find out about their big ochre mine they had there for the last 400 years or something. And one guy that I got to be good friends with said that his family, most people would come in on a creek bed for about 20 miles and finally come up to the mine. It's way up on the side of a cliff. But he said his family just found a faster way in, and they made a big agave rope and dropped down to it. So they did make ropes.
Wow.
But if you want to pass this around, you know, that's it. I'm sure I've left a lot out, but I can't see.
Thanks, Paul.
You're very welcome.
Is it better to let it dry for a while?
Oh, you have one. And you see, it's coming off. I don't want to go so deep that it starts to fray all over the place. That means I'm getting into the fiber. This is a real fine fiber. It's pretty different from the yucca fiber. Now, if there's another class going on, don't let me hold you up.
Is there another class?
So map and compass would be here, would it? I think it starts here, huh?
Be here, thanks.
Well, they'll tell us when it's good, I guess. You see what I'm doing? I'm just kind of loosening up this outer bark.
Might be Alan. It might be Alan Jensen's and it's a Chris Reed.
See, it's coming off a little bit, not a lot. I'm just kind of loosening it up. What we want to do is get rid of the interior portion of this. All of the fibers just under the surface. I probably should have done that. The more the better. Now, do we have a hammer stone around here?
One right there.
Or something that could function as well? Oh, perfect, yeah. Just give me the toss. Now, what I like to do, when you hit this, it'll usually bust into two main parts and two minor parts, or into fourths, to process it. So I just hit it like that. Sometimes you can just use your fingers and just go along it. See what's happening?
Yeah.
Okay, there you go. So it's really going into about four parts right now. You gotta be a little bit delicate or you'll make a mess out of it. Now just open it up into two parts. Like that.
and we'll just put this aside, and I'll start with this one. And what I do, I'm going to break it every few inches here, break it. But make sure you're not breaking it this way. So I break it off this way, it'll break the fiber, pull the fiber. So I'm breaking towards the fiber, like that, see? Hold it like this. The pieces are going away from me. And now I'm just going to go like this. Pull off a couple pieces. Go down. Pull off a couple pieces. See what's happening?
Yeah.
I lost some. I should be a little more careful. Some people are not careful at all. They have so much of it. But I like to try to conserve it. So I like to be a little bit delicate. So I take that off.
That's just like this piss part.
It's a little bit, it's a different kind of thing to work with.
Is it stronger than the yucca?
Yes.
Oh, it is?
Yeah. Once you get it rolled into cordage. It's not stronger at this point. It's got a beautiful color, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Now, how prevalent is dogbane? Is that?
You know, I think it's across the whole country, but it's like locally abundant. In other words, you have to figure out where it's growing in your 50 square mile area. Around Los Angeles in the mountains, it's fairly abundant, but it's very rare to find nice pieces. I found the only, what I consider the really good fishing site. Now,
that's where he told me
at
first, and I found it.
I'm gonna set this aside. I like to do it all together. It really saves a lot of time. So I'm gonna do this one the same way. In other words, I'm gonna bend like I just did with that one. This will make it actually, otherwise there's just not enough of it in one bunch. But what I'm gonna do is work that with my fingers eventually, get rid of all of the extraneous stuff, and try to leave the fiber. But I'm just gonna do the same thing here as I did right over there. Just come down it. Get rid of all of these. You gotta get rid of all of this interior pulpy wood.
Sure makes you appreciate your paracord more when you do it.
Well, but the beauty is that you can
make it
if you have to, you know.
Yeah. Or even if you just want to.
Or for the beauty of it.
Paracord for baskets.
I don't know, that has to just buy an extra 1,000 feet of paracord just to extend it.
I mean, and you were doing traps last time, weren't you?
Yeah.
And he was making these bird traps and all, and it's just amazing.
Oh, the one with the catches.
So, there I have it. Now I think what I'm going to do, and it just depends on how you're going to use it. I don't know which is the thin end here. I think that's the thin end. I think this is the thick end, so I'm just going to put them together like that. I can usually take it apart later. And then, I'm just trying to think. Probably just start out like this. Yeah. Some ways to see how that stuff's coming off?
Yeah.
That's all that little connective stuff. I mean, non-connective stuff. All the pulp is dried in there. But you see, already I'm getting fiber there. I mean, almost usable. Not at this point. To make the cordage, I dampen it. Yeah. Some people say you shouldn't, but I get it so much tighter dampening it, it's even though with the little expansion that takes place, it compensates, in my opinion. And you have to be somewhat careful. Sometimes I have to dampen my fingers just to hold on, as you just saw me do. Sometimes I might go like this.
And that actually
strengthens it by getting rid of the excess stuff that doesn't help, right?
Yeah, it just adds weight. It keeps the fibers from holding on to each other. When you see really old Indian cordage, like something you'd find in a cave or something, it's damn near perfect. When you see somebody trying to make Indian cordage, it's very different, usually. Or replicating it for a museum, you can usually tell right away.
Well, there's probably a certain level of mastery after 1,000 feet or something.
Well, you know, a lot of it is just standards. Modern people don't have much standards.
Well, modern people have a different sense of the time.
That's the key word, right? Yeah.
If I need to make sure it takes me 2 weeks to make the ball on arrow, I do it.
And if you're going to spend up your life with it, then you're going to be a lot more.
Yeah, even doing it for a class like this is a little bit upsetting because you can't just go at your own pace.
Right.
Just,
yeah.
You know what I mean?
You're under pressure here to produce straight.
No pressure.
You got another class.
This isn't perfect, but it sure gives you a good, clear idea of what we're talking about. Just to help this. I'm not going to make cordage out of it. I certainly could, but I want you to be able to see it.
You could
as fiber.
Feeding it tie down or something.
Yeah, I'm just rolling it a little bit so it just hangs together. But then you can pass that around to get a sense of it.
And then you use the same technique to...
Same thing.
Yeah.
Same thing.
Wow.
I mean, every material has its little...
Amazing.
...nuances and stuff, but you'll pick that up in a second.
Yeah. Wow. It's beautiful. It's really... I added my little scraps that I get that are good into the binker basket. It's beautiful. Decoration, that's all I could do. Yeah.
It's
pretty
good. It's
really cool. Thank you.
Oh, yes. Thank you.
See that.